بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف خلق الله سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. ثم أما بعد, all the praise and all the glory is due to Allah, and I bear witness that there is no God but Allah and that Muhammad is his last prophet and messenger. May the blessings and peace of Allah be upon our Prophet Muhammad, his family, his companions, and those who followed him up to the day of judgment. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We continue explaining the prophetic traditions on the legal rulings of Umdat al-Ahkam. And Umdat al-Ahkam, as we explained in the previous episodes, is a book which relied mainly on the authentic ahadith agreed upon by al-Bukhari and Muslim. And those ahadith concentrate on the legal rulings. I remind myself and I remind you of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam: "من يريد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين." Whomever or whoever Allah subhanahu wa taala likes goodness in this life and the hereafter, Allah provides him with proper understanding in of his religion. So we are on the fourth hadith of Umdat al-Ahkam. The fourth hadith is on the book of purification. The hadith reads as follows: On the authority of Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, If any one of you performs ablution, he should put water in his nose and then blow it out, and whoever cleans his private parts with stones should do that with odd numbers, and whoever wakes up from his sleep is to wash his hands three times before dipping them in the utensil, because nobody knows where his hand has spent the night. The first legal ruling of this hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِذَا تَوَضَّأَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَجْعَلْ فِي أَنْفِهِ مَاءً, which means the necessity of rinsing mouth and nose, which is istinshaq. And some jurists took the imperative and the command on this hadith to indicate that it is imperative and it's obligatory to rinse the mouth and cleanse the nose in ablution. And they extended the same ruling for ghusl also. According to Malik and Ash-Shafi'i, both acts are sunnah. But according to the other scholars, Imam Ahmad and Imam Abu Hanifa, it is obligatory. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, or the Prophet ﷺ gives a command in the hadith, it turns into an obligation. This obligation, according to the scholars of usul al-fiqh, or the scholars who are concerned with the methodology of eliciting rules, if this statement of the Prophet ﷺ contradicted by another act or another statement of the Prophet, so in this way we try to reconcile. So according to Ash-Shafi'iyya and Imam Malik, they interpreted this hadith in terms of another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which when a Bedouin came to him and said, tell me about the obligatory acts of ablution. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you should be referred to the ayah, to the Quranic verse. The Quranic verse in Surah Al-Ma'idah talked about the basic obligatory acts of ablution, which are washing the hand, the face, washing the hands up to the elbows, wiping over the head, and washing the feet. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam referred the Bedouin to the basic obligatory acts of ablution. Consequently, the scholar said that madmada and istinshaq are both recommended. The question now, how a person makes madmada and istinshaq according to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is explained in the authentic hadith of Zayd may Allah, Zayd ibn Asim, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took one handful of water, and through this handful of water, he practiced a madmada and istinshaq. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took from the same handful of water, the water that rinsed his mouth and rinsed his nostrils. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this hadith, so he took three handful of waters, cleansing the nose and the mouth. And the scholars said in this context that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that it is istinshaq. And istinshaq is taken from the Arabic word istinshaqa or nashaqa, which means he inhaled. So the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to inhale water inside the nose. Even according to another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are required to exaggerate in making madmada and istinshaq. According to the authentic hadith of Laqit ibn Sabira, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, perfect your ablution, try to wash in between the two fingers or between the fingers of your hands, and finally you must, according to the hadith, exaggerate in inhaling water inside the nose, except if you are fasting, so that a person is recommended to exaggerate in taking the water inside the nose, except if he is fasting. And this also, this point of the hadith, except he is fasting, also gives us another point, which is if water falls in from the nose to the cavity or to the mouth, or actually it goes into the stomach, it invalidates ablution, according to this hadith, according to the hadith of Laqit ibn Sabr. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited, or he disliked exaggerating in taking madmada or istinshaq during the time of fasting, because there may be something that may fall. The scholars only differed about in case of fasting, if there is some drops of the eyes may fall inside the eyes, and it may have a way to the cavity or a way to the stomach. In this case, if it falls, it may nullify the ablution, but in most cases it does not, except in some exceptional cases. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talked about another issue, which is istijmar. And istijmar is a normal way of removing the traces of urine, and when a person answers the call of nature. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the word istijmar in Arabic is restricted to using pebbles or stones. In fact, according to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we can use all materials, everything that may actually remove the traces of urine or the after answering the call of nature. Mainly if a person can use even towels, if he can use a piece of cloth, if he can use any materials, it is permissible. There is no harm, as long as it is not bones, and number two, it is not dung. It is not bones because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited using the bones, and he gave us the reason. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, because it is the food of our jinni brothers. And every dung that is left, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it or transforms it back into the original status, and then it becomes the food of the animals of the jinn, according to the authentic hadith. According also to the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to answer the call of nature, and he asked Abdullah ibn Mas'ud to bring him three pieces or three pebbles. Ibn Mas'ud brought him two, and he did not find a third. So he brought him actually a dung. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the two pebbles and he threw out the dung and said, innaha rijs, or innaha riks. And this hadith is in fact narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari as authentic hadith in the book of al-Bukhari. The third legal ruling of this hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited dipping one's hand in the utensil until he cleans it first. And the reason that the Prophet ﷺ said, because a person doesn't know where his hand slipped or where his hand used to be. And from this statement, the scholars concluded that it is obligatory for a person before, if a person uses a utensil for washing himself, and this is in fact extended to people actually using utensils for medical purposes and using other utensils. So if a person uses a utensil for making ablution, he is not permissible to perform the ablution before pouring water over his two hands. This is explained in the hadith of Himran, the client of Uthman ibn Affan. It's narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, and the hadith of Zayd also, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam washed his hands before immersing them in the utensil. Some scholars said that it is obligatory, like Imam Ahmad. He said it is a must that a person, before making ablution, that he should cleanse his hands, because he doesn't know where he actually spent, where his hands during the night. And some scholars said that it is only in case of doubt. If a person doubts whether his hand is clean or unclean, and they said this is one of the etiquettes the person must take care when he is washing his hands from a utensil. And some scholars said that it is not obligatory and it's only recommended. And they relied actually on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which he referred the Bedouin to the ayah of Surah Al-Ma'idah, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specified the obligatory acts of ablution. Number two, the hadith of its context itself. The context of the hadith has a clue which gives us a hint that it is not obligatory, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَدْرِ أَيْنَ بَاتَتْ يَدُهُ. He doesn't know where was his hand. Which means that when the Prophet ﷺ made it as a condition, that in terms of doubt, so if a person is not doubtful, he may be exempted of washing his hands before immersing them in the utensil. Also, the scholars derived a rule from this hadith. For example, if a person doubts about the purity of his clothes, or he doubts the purity of his mattress or the carpet, what is the required way in this case? The scholars said, according to this hadith, that the Prophet ﷺ said he must wash it three times because he does not know where was his hand. Meaning that the Prophet ﷺ was talking about a case of doubt. So the scholar said, if a person doubts about a status or something, whether it is pure or impure, he should wash it three times. He must wash it three times. Another scholar said, no, it is not obligatory actually to wash it, the doubted area, three times, and it's only to just sprinkle water of the impure area or the area which is a spot of doubt. And they relied also on the practice of Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, who used to do this regularly when he doubts the purity of any spot, that he actually used to just sprinkle water. And sprinkling water does not necessarily mean that the person overflow it and rub it, but is it just throwing some drops of water on it. And actually sprinkling water is recommended, or it's obligatory on another case, because the scholars divided, or they classified the categories of najasa into three basic categories. The highest category is the severest one, which is the impurity resulting from the saliva of the dog. When the dog licks in any of the utensils, it is obligatory to wash it seven times, one of them with dust or with dirt, according to what we are going to explain in another hadith. And the medium, which is when a young child, a child who is not weaned, a child who relies on breastfeeding, is urinating, according to the authentic hadith of Umm Mihsan, that she brought the Prophet ﷺ a baby and he urinated in the lap of the Prophet ﷺ. So the Prophet ﷺ just overflowed, sprinkled water on it. And according to the other hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, which is also mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, that the Prophet ﷺ was brought a child and he just commanded the Sahaba to just overflow water on it. And there is a third hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said, it is enough to just sprinkle water for the boy, the baby boy, and to wash the place or the piece of clothes if urine of a baby girl falls. And actually the scholars discovered a scientific miracle in this hadith. They found that the urine of the baby girl is thicker, and especially at that time, especially before reaching the age of two, and the urine of the baby boy is lighter. And this is a miracle which is expected. And the normal way of najasa, of removing najasa, is to actually wash it three times. And the scholar said that this is the recommended way of removing all types of najasat, provided that the filth itself is removed. The filth itself is removed. So as long as there is a trace of urine, a trace of defeces, and a trace of blood whatsoever is remaining on the blood, on the body, or in the piece of clothes, it's still obligatory that the person must wash it until it is removed completely, according to the Prophet's hadith sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he commanded the woman when she asked him about the way to wash the menses. The Prophet ﷺ said, you must rub it with your hand, overflow water on it, and remove it completely. And remove it completely.
Ask Hoda.
Dear brothers and sisters, welcome to a new edition of Ask Huda.
I have two questions.
Please go ahead. You can read it in Arabic, and you can also understand the meaning in your own language. The different tafsir and the interpretation of the meanings of the Quran are available in almost every language that exists on earth by the grace of Allah. The water of Zamzam is for whatever intention you drink it with. Salih from Egypt, his father has the way, and he asked about how can he help him. Very good question.
Can we give a zakat to any of the dawah centers?
The ibadah, or the act of worship, is a part of the unity of worship. It has to be paid to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in accordance with the guidance of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa
The fifth hadith, we are going to go through it inshallah very quickly. And this is the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anha. And this is the fifth hadith of Al-Umda. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, لَا يَبُولَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي الْمَاءِ الدَّائِمِ الَّذِي لَا يَجْرِي ثُمَّ يَغْتَسِلُ مِنْهُ وَلِمُسْلِمْ لَا يَغْتَسِلْ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي الْمَاءِ الدَّائِمِ وَهُوَ جُنُبْ. On the authority of Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, who said, the Messenger of Allah said, you should not pass urine in stagnant water which is not flowing. Then you may need to wash in it. According to the version related by Muslim, do not let anyone defiled by a state of janaba, ritual impurity, take a bath in stagnant water. This is one of the whole system of cleanliness in Islam, protecting the environment of any contamination or pollution. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is directing it to an environment which is only desert land. The Bedouins, who did not know how to the basics of cleanliness, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving them instructions about the basic rules of purifications, prohibiting them actually of urinating in stagnant water, it is one of the most instructive ways. In fact, this is, according to the correct understanding of this hadith, that it is prohibited, according to this hadith, to urinate in stagnant water, because the stagnant water catches impurities and the bacteria, and it's a place for the bacteria. So the Prophet ﷺ says, it is not conceivable for a sane person that he urinates in stagnant water and later on he performs janaba, he performs a ritual bath by using the same water, because it is something which is detestable, something which is disliked. And the scholars understood from this hadith that it is absolutely prohibited. And some scholars understood that it is even this water in which it is urine or impurity falls is actually rendered impure. But the correct view about the purity and the impurity of water may be actually explained by the following rule. If the water is so great in its volume, so whatever amount of najasa falling in it, it is still pure as long as there is no change in its color, in its smell, or in its taste. As long as there is no change and the water is so superfluous, it's so much, in this case, it is still it is pure and no problem of using it. According to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that there is a well which is called Buda'a, and the Sahaba used to have it, and this well used to have a lot of impurities falling within. So the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba asked the Prophet ﷺ about it, and he said, إِنَّ الْمَاءَ طَهُورٌ لَا يُنَجِّسُهُ شَيْءٍ. The basic rule is that water is pure and it is not rendered impure by anything. This hadith is narrated or related by the three narrators of hadith, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, and An-Nasa'i, and it is an authentic hadith. So the Prophet ﷺ gives us the rule that as long as the water did not change, it is still pure. So if it is small in amount, and the scholar differed about this small amount, and some of them said that it is, if it is less than two qullas, according to Al-Shafi'i, the two qullas are almost 200 liters, according to what the scholars explain. So if it is less than 200 liters, and an impurity, a spot of blood, a spot of urine, whatsoever falls within, even if it does not change the color or the taste of the water, it is rendered impure, according to Al-Shafi'iyya. It is rendered impure. And this is the view. According to some other scholars, they said they relied only on the basic rule of a change. And they said, as long water changes, so it is rendered impure. If it doesn't change, it is still pure. And this is the correct view because it relies on some other rules of Sharia. In fact, Islam prohibited urination in some places. Like, for example, under the in the shadow of people, according to the authentic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And also the Prophet prohibited urinating in a place where in running water, in the river where people drink. And he also prohibited in the road of the people and under the trees and in places where people take rest. And this is a part of removing harm. So it is also, we take from this hadith that it is absolutely prohibited to introduce any harm or make any mischief on the earth, because the Prophet ﷺ made it as a rule, even if throwing urination or doing anything. The Prophet ﷺ said, لا ضرر ولا ضرار. There is no harm to be inflicted or recyclated. And also from this hadith, we have a clue. Some scholars said that used water cannot be used for lifting a state of ritual impurity, like because the Prophet ﷺ said this water is used, or it is if there is a spot of water or some water used for ablution, for example, is it permissible to use it again for lifting a state of ritual impurity? There is a difference among the scholars, but the best rule or the preferred rule that it is permissible to use the used water. And by the used water, we mean water which a person used for obligatory parts in ablution. Like, for example, if a person uses water just for washing his hand, this is not called used water according to the scholars, to the scholars' terminology. The used water, according to their terminology, is the one which is used for lifting a state of ritual impurity. So the scholars said using water again is permissible, because there we have other ahadith of the Prophet ﷺ. On the top of them, when the Prophet ﷺ visited Jabir ibn Abdullah, as mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, and the Prophet ﷺ found Jabir very sick and he was very ill. So the Prophet ﷺ made ablution and then he brought the water and he gave it to Jabir. May Allah be pleased with him and said, make ablution through this. Which gives us a hint or a proof that the Prophet ﷺ allowed him used water. And also in the hadith of Al-Hudaybiyah, when the Prophet ﷺ made ablution and the Sahaba were competing of taking water, because the Prophet ﷺ, it's permissible during his lifetime to apply water, to seek his blessings, to seek the blessings of the Prophet ﷺ while he is alive. After the death of the Prophet ﷺ, it's also not permissible to seek him for a blessing. Such is the case for any person else. Because according to the hadith of Umar ibn Khattab, you remember when he cut the tree under which the Prophet ﷺ made the pledge of allegiance, because he disliked that the people may have a fitna of seeking blessings of this tree. So basically, the Prophet ﷺ allowed using the used water in ablution and in ghusl also, according to the hadith of Maymuna, when the Prophet ﷺ and Aisha radiallahu anha, that the Prophet ﷺ used to take water from here and here, and she used also take the same water from the same utensil, and they used to exchange it while they had janabah, which means that the leftover of a woman is permissible to use and the leftover of a man is permissible to use, and even the used water of both of them is permissible to use by the other side. These are some of the legal rulings that we could derive and the scholars talk about from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the recommendation of washing hands three times before immersing them in the utensil, and the hadith of the prohibition of urinating in standing water. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His mercy upon all of us and to bring us peace and tranquility and to benefit us from all pieces of knowledge. إنه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. صلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.